So start now. Okay. Good morning, friends. It gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Jawahar Sarkar, a colleague from the Indian Administrative Service, a friend, and more than a friend, I'm a great admirer of his forthright views, his courage to speak the truth, and his beautiful way in which he writes. And his writing is just not political or stuff that we bureaucrats are more familiar with, but his interests range from culture. I mean, the first time I heard him was when he was talking about goddess Durga in such an authoritative way that I was just floored, because it's very rare for bureaucrats to know things outside the four walls of policy making. And, you know, on culture and issues related to culture, it's very rare that you have people with such deep knowledge and understanding. He quit the service after being the chief of the Prasad Bharati, where he was appointed, and has been writing furiously from his base in Calcutta. He's an intellectual and he's very much admired by all of us in the civil services, and rightly, and to our great, relief and happiness, the government of West Bengal, the party Trinamool Congress, has nominated him, and he is now today a member of parliament from Rajya Sabha. And we feel very honored in a very vicarious way, because I think it's wonderful to have Jawahar represent so many interests and unspoken voices in Rajya Sabha. So today he's going to talk on civil services in India, and let's hope that you'll all get more deep insights into how we function. Jawahar, it's all yours.
Good morning, friend. I hope I can be heard. Okay. Let me start by thanking Manthan for giving me this opportunity to come across to you. My views would be as filtered as I can maintain them. So it's an early warning. I've managed to speak what I felt was the closest to truth, and I've survived to tell you, come and speak to you today. Now, having said that, I thank Manthan for inviting me to this August gathering. I thank Ajay Vikram, and I also thank Sujata, who's been a wonderful colleague, a slightly senior colleague, and we remember senior and junior in the service. And I'll go straight into the subject. My tryst with the civil services begins some 47 years ago when I was a management trainee in a blue chip company. And I, in a misplaced fit of patriotism, I decided to sit for the civil services examination. Somebody must have made a mistake. I got in. So that's my beginning. And it went on much too long, 42 years almost. Having said that, let me assure you that I started from a normal private sector job, moved in there, not being fully integrated, if one may put it that way. And I have now quit for the last 4 years. And now, as Sujata tells you, I have been made an MP for absolutely no fault of mine. I happen to be a member of the Rajya Sabha, and I watched a lot of tumult in the last fortnight. Okay. I can assure you on one score that very few services anywhere in the world can be as rewarding, as fulfilling, as frustrating. My God, the level of frustration I can compare. As frustrating, as full of new challenges, and as decisively low paid. As the world goes past you, you observe all these things. But these are from the point of view of one who has gone through it. What the nation needs to know, borrowing a phrase, but the nation needs to know why the heck, what the hell is going around where the civil services are concerned. What about your performance? Why is it so poor? Why is there so much political connivance? Why is there so much poor output? And what are the reasons? What I'll do is make an attempt in my own way, and it's highly subjective, but based on, let me say, empirical evidence gathered over 4 decades. And at occasional intervals, I've squeezed them all together, tabulated them, and I've come across certain postulates. To begin with, the civil services are a bit like, I'll use a very hackneyed phrase, civil services are a bit like spouses. This is a term used by the famous Rusi Modi of Jamshedpur, of Tata Jamshedpur, who used to say that you guys are like spouses, not that he had one. One can't live with you, one can't live without you. That's his way of putting it. I would put it that the civil services are more like a fan above you. You don't notice them. You're not supposed to notice them as long as they're doing their job. It's only when there's a breakdown, only when there's only when the fan stops moving that you look up and start giving your comments. I'm not going to be defensive about what the services have meant. And as I said, I'm trying to take a distance from it all. Even within the service, I was not a great admirer because I'm compiling all the essays that one has written. Not a great admirer. I've been caustic about certain things. So here goes. What do you think is the size of the civil service? Any idea? Well, I'll give you a rough one. It's around 2.5 crores. 2.5 crores, out of which, this is based on pay commission, the last pay commission calculations, 33 lakhs in the central government. We are not adding 14 lakhs in the army, and we are not adding the 50 lakhs pensioners. That includes me. Incidentally, the number of pensioners will go on increasing compared to those in active service. So you have 33 lakhs in the central government. And approximately 2 to 2.10 crores, that's a large number, but that's also required, in the state services, in the state. So that takes us to 2.5 crores, and you can put that as a percentage of 140 crore Indians. Just for information, this percentage of civil servant or bureaucrat to normal human beings is comparatively low. It's not as high as you think. It's much lower. The public services in the most advanced countries account for a much higher percentage. But we'll come to that. It's not quantity that matters. It is quality and attitude. Those are different things. Now, the first mistake or the first impressions that all of us have is the civil service is equal to the IAS. For some reason, because the IAS is more around you all the time, or you know many more of them, it's automatically equated with the IAS. Hang on. In the central bureaucracy, the IAS accounts for just 500. It's not even 500 now. It's less than 500. 500, and that out of 33 lakhs. And that is 0.015%. I hope I've got myself. 0.015%. How much the wafer can move the ice cream is a matter of conjecture. We have a thin wafer, and when we have a large blob of ice cream, until it starts melting the wafer does not make much of an impression, as you know. But that's it. Now, you can always turn around and say, but you guys are manning all the senior posts. We'll come to that. In the states, as I've said, the percentage is even lower, much too negligible to count. In about 2 crore public servants in the states, all put together, the IAS accounts for 5,000. We stopped calculating. As I've kept saying, it's wafer thin. But the logic that cuts both ways is that A, these persons occupy most of the critical posts. B, but that is what it's supposed to be. It's a management cadre. It's like the Tata Administrative Service. You're supposed to be there. I mean, they were recruited. Many of them left good jobs or better jobs to come. So it is the management cadre and it does matter. So in a way, often at times, we keep saying the driver is not at fault if the automobile itself is bad. Well, I'll put it this way. Partly true. But the driver also had a hand in occasionally tampering around, in occasionally setting the automobile. So it's not really that he's being driven. Now, moving on to the other services, the IPS, the Indian Police Service, is almost the same as the IAS and selected much the same way. So the numbers will be around the same. Other central services are there, but all put together, the higher civil services just do not matter when it comes to numbers. Numbers. What they do by way of influence is something different. Now, we often see only the pomposity angle, the overbearing angle, which is largely true, But then in my last flight back from Delhi yesterday, I found myself being pushed back and back because a PRO of a private company was desperate to make an impression with his boss by pushing him on to the first row. The pomposity is not the monopoly of any particular group, but well, it is an acquired trait that sinks in very easily into civil servants. And we'll come to that later because it's one of the most nauseating things that one has to put up with. Having given you the top numbers, top of the pyramid numbers, let's come to the bottom. You and I usually meet the clerk, the dealing assistant, the junior officer, the peon, and the constable sub-inspector, the cutting edge of government. And that is frighteningly bad. It's bad for you, it's bad for me. I can assure you, because they are agnostic when it comes to whoever is there. I mean, they're non-boss agnostic. If you're not the boss, they couldn't care much about you. And this is more of a third world phenomenon. But here, this particular nauseating phenomenon in India has a long historical tradition. So let me get fast forward to where the rot actually begins. We are inheritors of the colonial civil service and we have managed to sort of tinker around with the body, make shape, put new names. New names are put in now almost every week by the, what I call the Scrabble boys of Delhi. There are whole dedicated teams of Scrabble players employed by a particular regime in Delhi to go on renaming schemes so that at the next Monkey Bath or something, you get a new name. Now, I'll start the history and start in any one of the three ends from which India was throttled, captured. Bengal, Madras, and Bombay. And all three experiences are different, but similar in their own way. They went through their own local issues and local historical circumstances. So I am taking Bengal, and in very short, the British opted to inherit, favor, and employ the most rotten set of humans that were part of the post-Mughal bureaucracy. I mean, I can describe it in more colorful terms with a lot of examples why I'm calling them rotten. And at every level of the penetration of Bengal, because that was the bridgehead from which the fellows came in and kept on strangulating their hold, it is in the same story. The post-Mughal bureaucracy in Bengal, like elsewhere, was absolutely rotten. It was stinking from half a mile. You could smell it from Madras to Arcot if you wanted. But then it was there. Instead of replacing it with a European bureaucracy, European white cleanliness and all that, the British chose to re-employ them and chose to strengthen them, chose to make them more permanent than what the successors of Mughals did not. Now, if you notice, the words that historians use for this phase of British power, which starts with 1757, the Battle of Plassey, and moves on to 1857, the War of Independence or Sepoy Mutiny, in this 100 years, this period of consolidation of British power is variously known by various names, but I'll tell you the secret of all these names today. They're called paramount power. They were called dominant power. They were called suzerain power. Occasionally sovereign power. Why do you use such nomenclatures? Historians are fond of these nomenclatures, but if anyone in law or academics get to them, each one denotes something different. A paramount power is not one who's messing around in the kitchen all the time. He prevails upon the kitchen, which is a different matter. So this prevalence thing, it took a long time in Bengal presidency for about 40-45 years to change it all around. Let me put it like this. We have spoken about three presidencies, but where two of them were concerned, it was primarily directed by the legitimate head of sovereign power in India, the jure power of India, the Mughals. The Mughals had lost much of their sheen, but they were still the dominant power. And there was a lot of salami slicing of powers. You know, the Brits took it in bits and pieces, like that, like you cut off Bob. And in the example that I know in a certain amount of depth, they first started with only revenue. That's where the mullah came in. The revenue without a stick. Then they went in for revenue through outsourcing completely to Indian powers, the rotten Indian post-Mughal bureaucracy that I've said. Then another stage, they come in with their own people and their otters. Then they go in for a stage where they retain the veto power, the power to intervene, but actually allow others to operate as long as they get the revenue. Finally, they start legitimizing their power by getting civil administration on. The civil administration was being carried on by the Mughal and his appointees as the Diwani Adalat, the Sadar Diwani Adalat. The British start sitting in judgment in Sadar Diwani Adalat as judges. And then the last stage was when they'll get criminal powers or Fauzdari Adalat powers, Fauzdari or Nizamat Adalat powers. In five stages, they went on cutting into the body. And in different stages, they acquired different hacks, different parts of the Indian body, polity, the Indian administration, and Indian administration. And the point I'm making is that no point of time did they come in singly and decide to set up their own administration. They were basically inheriting an administration, using the same terms to recruit people, giving them the same pass, and allowing the virus to continue. Well, by the 19th century, the Parliament of Britain went in for a series of legislations and tried to intervene. But then by that time, it was getting too late. Incidentally, the first 50 to 70 years was not a corrupt regime in the sense that the Indians were not the only ones. The phenomenal amount of corruption that the British indulged in is a different story. I'm talking of British civil servants. The phenomenal amount of private trading that they did, the amount of powers that they seized, the economic offenses that they trade, and all of you are aware that the East India Company was the biggest drug lord of the world. They were selling opium. So we will not get into the morality of the issue. All I'm saying is the civil service in India is an inheritor of this glorious tradition. You have too much of Tehsildar, Patwaris and Kannams and others seeped into the body without anyone really being able to pluck them out with no vaccine available. No completely treatable vaccine available. Now, some of the consequences of this have been very horrifying. Like in Bengal, the early experiments, led to the famine of 1770 and the consequences, 1/3 of Bengal's population, 1/3 of it was decimated. 1 out of 3 persons in Bengal was killed because the British were fooling around with Tehsildars, Omils, Kanungo, Sadars and others and didn't know how to set it up. So these consequences have been terrible. The short point is that this extortionist, hegemonistic, corrupt regime continued as an ethos. If any of you see parallels even today, the least I can contribute is to tell you that, well, it's about 200 years old. Later attempts to purge them were inefficient, insufficient, and too ingrained, at least where the bottom of the pyramid was concerned. Well, the upper echelons were protected, watched much more, and there was a lot of cleansing that was going on. But my submission is that changes in the bureaucracy, changes in the civil services, right from the top to bottom that went on, were more structural in nature. They were not attitudinal changes. The attitude continued to be inherited. And I can assure you that when I left the private sector to join one, I was extremely surprised when my bag was taken away from my hand on the first day. I was only 23 and I was gently hinted, I was gently told that Sahab don't carry bags. As Kaushik Basu, my classmate, put it, that when he first saw his bags being taken away at the gate of North Block, he thought of running after the fellow who took the bag, but that was a sign of obesity. That's it. So this attitudinal change was not possible, did not become possible at all. And one of the reasons why I've tried to rationalize is that at the root of the administration that we have had for 200 years and even beyond that, I include the 70, 75 years that somebody shouts about all the time as part of this continuing legacy, was aura, overawe, aura. Let me give you two examples of aura. What was the size of the British bureaucracy that we talk about in Jallianwala Bagh, in many other places, the oppressive British bureaucracy and all that? So you can take a couple of measures. On January 1930, if you remember, one of the most historic things that happened was Pandit Nehru unfurled the Indian flag, or whatever the Indian flag at that point of, the Congress flag at that point of time, saying we want Purna Swaraj, complete independence of the British. And at that moment in 1930, the number of ICS officers available to control every nook and corner, every junction of Indian administration was 1014. Out of which 367 were Indians. 2/3 white, 1/3 Indian. Just 1,000. Available, because they were very liberal with leaves. I wish this tradition does not exist in the IAS. They were very liberal with leaves. Available at any point of time was 850 to 900 ICS officers. The police would be, the imperial police would be a similar number. So 900, 900, 1800 chosen men controlling a territory of 1 million square miles, and a population of 250 million. I'm not talking of the bottom of the pyramid purposely, because that would elongate my conversation. This was the size, the tiny size of the bureaucracy through which the British ruled intentionally, because they knew what mattered was aura. Aura, the threat, the fear, the distancing. You can say, always say that this must have changed after they left. Well, I joined as SDO, Sub-Divisional Officer, Sub-Divisional Magistrate, in 1977. That's quite a time after 1947, 30 years after 1947, I joined as SDM. And I was in North Suburban Calcutta, just outside Calcutta, supposed to be more advanced. The first police station I inspected, called Deganga, horrified. apart from tin roof and no cats on top of them, digging roofs, miserable conditions, but old British, mini bungalow type, inspection bungalow type office. Deganga is an old police station. I was horrified because when I asked them the strength, they said they had 7 sub-inspectors and 7 assistant sub-inspectors, 14 of them, out of which 4 were on leave all the time. So that left an effective strength of 10. And if you put that in shift, at any point of time, we didn't have more than 3 junior non-commissioned, non-gazetted officers manning a police station. That's all. 3. Number of constables, 8 to 10 at the most. And Deganga police station commanded an area of 1.25 lakhs. It was 200 square kilometers. I mean, it's mind-boggling. So you were having 3 non-gazetted officers and something like 8 or 10 constables. It was aura that mattered. I'm even talking 1977. This was the trick of aura that mattered, the distancing. Unfortunately for us, this distancing that started and may have been a necessity at the field level for law and order at that level continued to be ingrained, continued to be a part of the psyche, and which is the most repulsive thing about the bureaucracy. And I have felt about it so many times, but then one cock in a pool doesn't make much of a difference. I remember an occasion when Dr. Karan Singh, I was then Culture Secretary of India, so I had to face a lot of people much more qualified, much senior. I remember Dr. Karan Singh caught me at a social gathering and said, "Jawahar, I keep writing to you and I get replies from some weird fellow called such and such, undersecretary." I said, "Sir, you do?" He said, "Of course, I have not received a reply from you." I went back and checked up the file and I found, lo and behold, Dr. Karan Singh was correct. Every time his letter came up, it would come up with all sorts of funny notations, of which I could boldly say, "No, I don't agree with the Babu. Please tell Dr. Singh that we shall be granting this and this to him at the earliest. We must tell him." That's all. Put up. Put up means please place it back to me. Put up to them meant that we will issue the letter on your behalf. For some reason, I never noticed that the letters were not coming back to me. After that, I stopped this horrendous colonial practice. I had a stenographer, and later on, as things became more uncontrollable, I started typing myself, which was a sheer sense of horror to my staff. Or I started sending draft emails to my private secretary and saying, please put them out on those fancy papers with Ashok Stamba and all that put on top. Make it look pompous. I'll come and sign it. That's all. Okay. So I found that a simple thing like replying to a very senior person who was a cabinet minister when I was in school and is still around. God bless him. The system didn't permit me. The system permitted the elicitation of the wisdom of the boss, namely me, what I felt about it. But the moment I elucidated what I felt about it, it went down the pecking order. And there one undersecretary would use his pompous, his most arrogant English and grammatically incorrect English to convey to the rest of India what the rulers had felt like. This is an offshoot of the Imperial Secretariat Service. The Imperial Secretariat Service felt that brevity is conveyance. Now, when Satyajit Ray says brevity is conveyance of an emotion, his heroine gets up the next morning after her first wedding night with just a bindi smudge, the economy of expression. It's understandable. But when this Babu says, "Ref, yours, sub yours," ref means reference yours, sub means your subject, undersigned is directed to say the matter shall be considered. The matter is dropped. Just one line, this remains an imperious tradition that could be attended to. Now, where my office is concerned, I managed to do it to some extent, but I'm sure they have reverted, sprung back to their old style of writing the moment I left. Now, these are things that need to be ordered out centrally. Now, when we talk of this thing in the blood, this sort of attitude in the blood, I hope I've been able to explain. It's not that the letter is not being attended to. It's the letter is being attended to at its own time. There's no hurry. It's being attended to and the opinion of the concerned boss is taken. And here again, the system is such that the lower bureaucracy decide whether secretary or additional secretary or whatever need not be disturbed. Wow, I came across this term, need not be disturbed. In other words, bosses are people who need to know, who are told on a need to know basis. Can you understand the mind under which you function? The huge body of mind that I am informed on a need-to-know basis. Now, while this is partially workable, it's not a criminal fault, but the fact is, even the occasion, even the opportunity of knowing whether I need to know is never open to me. So here I'm giving you insights into central bureaucracy. The state bureaucracy is more hilarious. I can give you more examples, but that will only take time. Now, if you think that the bureaucracy is terrible to denizens outside the bureaucracy, as a wise man once put it, India is composed of 100 crores. I don't know where he got the figures. 1 crore who work for the government, and 99 crores who have suffered at their hands. Now, this sort of a thing is quite common. And now that I'm out of it, I do get long tastes of the wisdom that I've heard of. But even within the bureaucracy, there's a pecking order. And let me give you into the secret of this pecking order. At the highest is what we call the ministry babus, the secretary, the additional secretary, the joint secretary, the deputy secretary, all of them, if you notice, look terribly worried and terribly in a hurry all the time. A wrinkle is formed at an early stage in our lives and it's encased somewhere here and is there permanently. So this is the pecking order where the ministry is my bap, mother, father, God, whatever. After that comes attached officers. The Central Board of Direct Taxes, Income Tax, the ones who make people's lives miserable, are known as an attached office of a ministry. Attached means, well, you are there, but you are really not the ministry. I remember when often talking about income tax and the member of the Income Tax Board, which is the highest body in India, would say, this has to go to government. I said, for God's sake, aren't you government? He said, no, I'm not government. Government is there in the ministry. So it goes on, attached office. And then you get subordinate office. Not that all of them are actually play out the role as subordinate. Many of them are quite insubordinate, I can assure you. We have subordinate officers like the Central Drugs Laboratory. These are all subordinate offices. India's full of subordinate offices. I don't know how you carry on such terms, but you still do 275 years after man made his foray here. But then you have subordinate offices, then the attached office, subordinate office. Then you have something very funny. This is hilarious. This is called autonomous organization. I haven't smelt even the beyond the word A in an autonomous organization, having presided over the destiny of some 50 of them as a ministry secretary and having suffered one as the CEO of an autonomous body called Prasar Bharati, looking after something like 480 stations of All India Radio and Doordarshan, again, for no fault of mine. Now, this autonomous body is something created normally by parliament or by good intention, but it's something worse than a subordinate body. And it consists of two types. You have some called corporate autonomous bodies, like PSUs, And you have something called statutory autonomous body, Prasar Bharati, airport authority, created by a statute, created by parliament and all its wisdom. So this is the pecking order. I mean, I won't get into tales of how they function among themselves, but they are both hilarious and horrendous. And down the order, people look straight at your shoulder pips to see where you stand. These are things that could be tackled or may not be ever be able to tackle. I'll give you why I'm saying this may not ever be purged. We had gone, I was then in the state government. I had gone with Mr. Jyoti Basu, I was the industry secretary, in a delegation to Britain. And after Mr. Basu had met the concerned minister of the government of the United Kingdom, and he had left, the permanent secretary, which means our counterpart, so to say, the secretary, and his officers, and we were sitting around a table, chatting and doing a bit of introductions. So when I was as deputy leader of the delegation, when I introduced that this is a corporation and this gentleman is a director, he said, "What's a corporation?" "Oh, it's a Soviet term." I get it. They call it parastatals. Okay. And the British secretary put it quite bluntly. So this guy is the one who takes you out for drinks at night. That's it. In other words, the system is that the system of subordination within the bureaucracy, who carries whose bag, who looks after whom, who can make life miserable for whom, is all established. And it's a court practice. It happened in the court of Versailles. It happens in Downing Street. It happens in Whitehall. It happens in Capitol Hill. Now, some of these are incurable diseases within the bureaucracy. And I can assure you, any of you, if you happen to come in by lateral injection to the bureaucracy, you will acquire these beautiful traits in exactly 3 months' time. You get used to it. So this is how it operates within this thing. Now, let's come across, we've given you the size, we've talked of attitude, we've talked of lots of things. Now, let's come to certain basic confrontational questions. Quality. Is the quality the same that we had for the ICS, the heaven-born service, or has the quality come down? Well, if you talk of the ICS, we can only compare it with the IAS. The first thing I can tell you, an official secret, now that I'm retired back, is that at any given point of time, the most mediocre IAS officer has to put in double the time that an ICS officer ever put in. At least double. There are no tennis courts where you can go at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. There are no horseback rides. All you have is people, complain, minister, MLA. It goes down the line. And then you go back home and have spouse. So it's quite regular. The quality, if you take the entrance quality, well, the entrance quality reveals that 40 to 45% are IIT and NIT graduates, and many of them are toppers. IIT, NIT, I think, is an established hallmark. And I think there are too many engineers, but that's my personal view. But having said that, 40 to 45%, and then you have doctors, you have management trainer for the qualified management training, you have higher education people, and you had graduates also, simple graduates, sharp ones. The Harvard Business School had commented at the process of recruitment and had said that this is tougher than what most would face in Harvard. And that's their comment. I'm only borrowing it. I can give you the reference sometime. What are the numbers? 11 lakh people fill in for preliminary. 11 lakhs. And to simplify matters, 1,100 get into the civil services. 1,100. That's all. Down the line, prelim is just a flaunting. What are you doing? I'm preparing for the prelims. I mean, it's a college hostel syndrome, whatever you say. However, the numbers come down when it comes to actuals. But 1,100 getting in place of 11 lakhs is 0.1%. Now, whatever a nation can throw up and whatever a nation can offer is there. In addition to that, there have been stages when lateral recruitments were taken. And I'm referring specifically to the lateral recruitment that the current prime minister tried out last 2 years. I think he got finally 8 out of 10 after a lot of furor. But don't misunderstand. The furor was not about whether lateral recruitment is required. The furor was about the rules of the game. If everybody else has gotten through a tough examination and has gone in through a tough training, a tough place, are you getting people coming in laterally and then leaving laterally? What if they take away the inside story, inside the workings of a ministry and then use it for private profit? Those concerns are there. Number one. Number two, what is the source of recruitment? Well, if you had it through the Union Public Service Commission, nobody could complain because a certain amount of fairness and a certain amount of objectivity. Even chaps like us got into the UPSC. So, I mean, the UPSC has its own way of looking at things. There are these issues that come in during recruitment, and the greater issue that concerns me is weeding out. And this is one thing I've kept on saying for years together. Why don't we weed out? Why don't we weed out? In other words, like if the army can weed out at periodic intervals the non-performers, why can't the IAS and other services weed out? This is one issue that needs to concern. And when the current prime minister, the former one, did come up and say that I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, so we can't put it on the former one. He was much too quiet. When somebody comes up with a historic mandate and says, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, why don't you attend to this small thing? Why don't you weed out the non-performers? Why don't you? He has thrown out quite a few corrupt people. That's only the tip of the iceberg. So these are issues that one needs to bother about: the recruitment, the training, the continuity, the lateral, the scope for lateral entry and the scope for lateral exit. Just like in the army, you are good enough as a major. Thank you. Goodbye. Here's your pension. Nice having met you. Why can't we build in system not only on the IAS but everywhere else? That would birth the civil services of people who don't like it either way. Now, there are three issues that have taken place which I need to draw your attention to and try to and take my talk to a closure. Three major issues that have taken place. You know, when I look back at those 42 years from a distance of almost 47, 48, 47. I see that in my lifetime, I have seen the last of the British era. We had pankha pullers, you know, people sitting outside with strings attached and fans on top of you in some of the offices and creaking out that pankha, that ceiling fan, manually driven ceiling fans. I've seen them and I've converted many O's to the post that became redundant after the introduction of electric fans. So we have seen the last edge of the British glory, if I may put it. I've gone through the thickest of permit control Raj. I was fond of telling people that I left a perfectly good private sector job to join the Soviet Socialist Republic of India. The Soviet Socialist Republic of India in 1975. So I've gone through the thick of permit control Raj and all the quotas and all the corruption and all the small things. If they find that you're not purchasable, the good thing that they do is try to give you a pen. I mean, they're tuned that way, that every piece of paper has its own cost. I've gone through that period. And gone through that period in Udyog Bhavan. God, that was the hotbed of whatever it is. So some other day I'll tell you the story. Then I've been in Udyog Bhavan, New Delhi, at a time when these Berlin walls were smashed about and we were given long mallets and hammers to do it. We did it in 1991, unleashing animal energy, not instantly, but after 94, 95. 91, nothing happened, only the rules were changed. But after 94, 95, you saw the revolution that happened in telecom, that happened in airlines. The very two sectors that are in crisis today, because we've jumped another stage from the post-91 stage, to the liberalization, to oligarchization. Oligarchies are being set up, and this is very dangerous. I'll come to that when I end. And in between this 1991, post-1991 liberalization, along with its accompanying corruption, and the energies that were released, and this oligarchy, the sell-off to oligarchs that is happening openly, was another medium stage, intervening stage called loot and scoot. I don't need to elaborate loot and scoot. They just, most of them happen to be from one state. I don't know why Mr. Desai must be laughing, but they happen to be from one state, except one who was from Karnataka. All of them practice the same thing, and none of them have been caught. Now, returning to where I was, the three markers out of this autobiographical note. One of them was the complete political takeover. Believe me, in my tenure, I have seen the complete political takeover. Whatever little independence, I could tick off an MLA in 1975-76. I could just tell him where he got off. I can't tell them now. Now it's all there in the rules. You can't say, even if you know that the fellow is, oh, I keep forgetting, I'm now on that side. But never mind, I've not joined the political side with that amount of dedication so far. Now, the complete political takeover is a post-Indira phenomenon. Post-Indira phenomenon, the best part of it is it is legitimate. It is legitimate. The Supreme Court has ruled in Royappa's case in 1974, that's Indira's time, and in Salil Sabloh's case 6 years ago in the Supreme Court, that a chief minister is fully at liberty to keep choosing his chief secretary, in which in most cases means something very, very difficult to understand. I'm not saying that all chief secretaries are bad or anything. It's just an indication that even the Supreme Court acknowledges absolute power of the political class to do absolutely what they feel like with civil servants, and the complete and enforced surrender to this sort of thing. People like me have managed by running away from the state at occasional intervals, then running away from the center to the state. But you know, these entail a lot of problems of derooting and uprooting. Now, this has happened. Government of India was much more impersonal. They went by your records, not by your face, not what they felt about you, not about your user friendliness, not about your malleability, but about many other things. But even that, Government of India has been systematically finished in the last few years, completely finished. So where do the civil servants who are already there get in? So there, the complete politicized political takeover is something that India has not complained about. Now, if India wants a very serious look at civil services, it has to make up its mind whether it's game for the American system of a politicized civil service, or if it wants a civil service to be a civil service, then far, far more insulating walls have to be done. I mean, in other words, the prime minister cannot, any prime minister or chief minister cannot scoot off any officer just because he has talked back. This was bad even 10, 15 years ago. I remember when I was empaneled as secretary, that been selected as secretary, which is quite unbelievably good to me. And I was told that I'm on the secretary panel, and I was given a gentle hint that there's an economic ministry going vacant and I should go and meet the minister. I did it promptly. If that's the rule of the game, I went and met him. And there in his room, I met someone who sort of said, the minister said, why don't you have a chat with my friend? He happened to be a fixer. And later on, I learned he was a part of a mafia. Somehow I felt very uneasy about the one or two conversations, the one or two hints and all that. You don't feel good. I said, to hell with this economic ministry posting. I'll settle for whatever comes on my way. So this used to happen even before. Right now, of course, it's only a one-man choice. the impatience of the political class. You must remember that the political class is not only here, it's impatient. And I'll give you one index. The Center for Monitoring Media Studies, headed by Dr. S.Y. Qureshi, my very respected senior, former chief election commissioner, he has brought out a series of reports, and one of them is the one on the 2019 election. It has gone unchallenged. It is provocative, but it has gone completely unchallenged. The government that and its cronies who keep threatening, I'll do this, I'll send you to jail, nobody's challenged. The figures are how much has been spent in election. In 1998, 9,000 crores for the cost, total unofficial cost of election. 1998, 9,000 crores. In 2014, it became 14,000 crores. In 2014, 10 years later, the entry of a different scale of politics in India, it became 30,000 crores. Divide that by the number of seats they won, and you know how much was spent. 30,000 crores, unchallenged figure. 30,000 crores, and in 2019, it is close to 60,000 crores. 55,000 crores. The report of the CMS, the Center for Media Studies, up on the website. Please have a look at it. The unchallenged report. With 55,000 crores, the ruling party alone got something like 26,000 crores. Where do you think this 26,000 crores is coming from? And how do you think it's going to be repaid? And who do you think will have to do it for you? Now you can put two and two together and you can understand why somebody, why the Prime Minister was on ranting mode in March, that everything, nothing is happening, the bureaucrats are stopping it all. No one wants to lose his job with that man by being a facilitator. I won't use the word no one. Most of them would not like to. Remember when Atal Bihari Vajpayee was Prime Minister, two hotels belonging to the Air India, Centaur Group hotels, were sold off through privatization route under a very honest minister called Arun Shuri. But the processes were such that the process were infallible. I mean, there's nothing you could do about it. They were, two of them were bought by a little known supporter of a big political party, the ruling party, obviously. And both of them were resold at a much higher cost within a very short time. You get the racket? If that could happen 10, 11 years ago, obviously reasonably honest civil servants will have their own doubts about it. The second thing that has happened, which I've already mentioned in the first, that is the takeover of the political class, is the post-liberalization syndrome. Post-liberalization syndrome of cronyism. Now, we can't blame everything to cronyism post-liberalization. There was some amount of cronyism in the Soviet regime also. But it's gone up manifold. It's gone up humongously over the last 20 years. People like us who welcomed liberalization, who fought against our seniors, who did away with these stupid forms, look back aghast at what Frankenstein have we let loose. Frankenstein's monster have we let loose. Cronyism. Small example. A former principal secretary to the Prime Minister becomes chairman of a toll company. And that toll company is milking the country. A problem is created by an honest officer. I mean, these are all subjective things. He himself is honest, but he prefers to get every office salary from the toll company. He goes and fixes it up. This is far before this racket started. Then we have the ILFS. The ILFS is one of the biggest scams that has happened, and it's happened so magnificently, no one takes much note about it. Just go through the Sucheta Dalal series on the ILFS and you know. And why I'm mentioning the ILFS is because the ILFS went in for murkier and murkier deals right now. Na Khaunga regime. It's gone through it in the past regime. It continues through this present regime. 175 subsidiaries were set up with, and 66 joint ventures. and most of them were in a shoddy shape. How did the guy do it? Arsarathi do it? He did it because of his complete control over the bureaucracy. No one knows how many IAS, IPS, and IFS or IRS and other officers were employed. We need to know these facts up on the website. How many of their relatives are employed? Here is a scam that could have been exposed, that could have been brought up to the notice of the people. Instead, it got hushed in. That's all. So what I'm saying is regime agnostic, regimes notwithstanding, this is happening. This is happening. And this is the greatest fear that haunts the bureaucracy right now. Other than this sort of a scamming that happens in a post-liberalization era, is that very juicy carrot called independent directorship. The last report of the company affairs, this is about 3 years old, shows that a SEBI chairman, ex-SEBI chairman who's on a board, draws 2 to 2.5 crores every year for the last 8 to 10 years. 2 to 2.5 crores we have never seen in our lifetime. So this is that the white way of making good money. A crusader, big crusader who brought governments down, goes on post-retirement, rewarded by this regime, and then takes over bodies, is appointed to various bodies, and his annual salary is 2 crores. I can give details if he wants to come up on board. 2 crores in other income is another crore or so. What is happening? This man was lauded as a crusader, but then post-retirement, the system got him. And the system manipulation is happening from a very tight corner. Every independent director worth his salt who is appointed by one man. Or men very close to him. There is a post reserved in Tata's for someone who comes in for an astronomical salary. And of course, he can always drop Tata's later to become a union minister also. These are interchangeable posts. But I'm just giving you the question, what is going on. The saving, another example, Indian Express brought out an expose in July last month, saying that the company affairs has said that out of the 11 regulators, retired regulatory body heads, 11, 6 of them are now employed in companies in which they had in companies that were within their were strictly within their conflict of interest areas. Why can't we implement a conflict of interest clause and just keep it, just hammer it through? I mean, I just can't understand. Unless, of course, there's a marked tendency within the political class to keep these things on. No cabinet secretary or company affairs secretary on his own can ever implement this conflict of interest thing that you, from the rest of your life, you cannot take up a job in which you had an interest as a regulator. What do you do? Mr. Nipendra Mishra, who comes up as chairman TRAI, and the TRAI Act says that you cannot have any other post-retirement, post-TRAI post ever again. The first thing Mr. Modi does after coming to power in 2014 is to amend that act so that Mr. Mishra can join as principal secretary to the prime minister. How can we expect the next TRAI chairman and the next TRAI chairman not to be subservient to a mega oligarch? The last point that I'll make is about rules and procedures. Rules and procedures remain pretty much the same that Lord Clive left us, Cornwallis left us, Elephant Stone left us. For some reason, there is absolutely no impetus to change it. We have already had 2 administrative reforms commissions set up, one in 1966, the other in 2005. Their reports are lying. now for years together. 2005, one report is lying now for 15 years. Nobody touches them. Frankly, I'm not so much bothered about the huge structural changes suggested by the Administrative Reforms Commission. I'm more bothered about the nuts and bolts. The nuts and bolts. Why can't we have a simple thing like a secret ballot in every office? It's not rocket science. A secret annual ballot in every office. You can define the office or section as 15 people, 20 people, whatever you want, where we have two ballot boxes, where the own employees, own colleagues, that's all, mark out persons with dubious integrity. Remember, since the larger number, I can tell you that on oath, since the larger number of civil servants are not corrupt, they get gnash their teeth when they see this corrupt colleagues getting away with it all and with political favor. So mark those who are corrupt and mark those with moral turpitude, those who don't have a correct attitude to gender. What happens after this? These results are then kept in by the office and exchanged in a pool. And in 3 years, you have a database, a very reliable database of who are the guys who are suspicious where integrity, financial integrity is concerned and moral integrity is concerned. With that database, I can assure you, if you take action after that, even the Supreme Court will listen. So you don't need rocket science to control these things. These are all very simple things. Right now, if you try to control an officer through the service classification, control and appeal rules, it takes about 20 years to fix him. 15 to 20 years. In my lifetime, I was signing punishment for those who have retired 10 years ago. And in my lifetime, the ones that I initiated, I'll never see. I mean, I have left service anyway. So it's so horrendously slow that unless we come up with out-of-box thinking, we'll never be able to stop these things. The secret ballot of officers perceived to be corrupt, secret ballot of officers perceived to be incorrect with women, can be kept started this year, and in 3 years' time, you have a database which goes on enriching itself over the years. And once a person's name is there, neutrally, we have a fast-track action to first remove him, first suspend him, first take him off duty, and then we talk. Unless you go in for such measures, the civil service will continue in the manner in which manner I have mentioned. So this is my take on it. I know I have been a little too hard. I'll sum up the five areas that I have mentioned to you once again, the ones that I've seen. I entered in the last vestiges of the British era, British glory. I went through permit control Raj, seen it all. Came through that period of unleashing of economic energies after 1991. Saw much of its putrefaction thereafter. Saw the Luton's court period and people going away blissfully. No one is brought back. No one is extradited. Whether you talk of Arthur Road prison or that prison, nobody is being extradited. These are all this drama ones going on. Luton's court period. We have also going right now through what we call the omnipotent oligarchies. Ladies and gentlemen, what frightens me the most is the last. The omnipotent oligarchies that are ruling India, that are getting strengthened with every move that's coming into India with absolutely no stoppage. The civil service is still a fine institution. When you look around the complete collapse of the civil service that happened in America, when you see the state of collapse, you know that a battered civil service in India has still not collapsed. And for the higher echelons, my constant reminder to my colleagues, we joined willingly as courtiers, make no bones about it. We were part of the power sharing system. We joined willingly as courtiers, but we shall not be made courtesans. There's a dividing line where you draw it. And let me assure you that the bulk of the people I have worked with are still honest. They may not be the topmost efficient because the efficiency was never really asked of them. They may be sunk in their rules because the rules are there and nobody changed them. Having said that, I still feel that the civil service in India, through all civil services in India, through all their permutations and combinations, have still a rich heritage. And I'm not even referring to the heritage of the rotten post-Mughal early colonial period. They have a heritage of dishing out public service. It's a question of how you ride the horse. How you ride the horse, how you coach the horse. With these words, I end my talk. Thank you very much. I'm open to questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Jawahar Sarkar. I think the last 1 hour has been, we've all spellbound. And from what you said in the beginning, you said you're giving a filtered version. I invite you to come to Manthan and yours also an unfiltered version. If this is a filtered version, I shudder to think what that version would be. For more than four decades of myself and Ajay working with the government, one phrase which I think fascinated me and which fascinates, I'm sure Ajay also, is the phrase of put up. We are informed that the file has been put up, and I'm always fascinated. What happens next? You know, what is this putting up? Because in our offices, in the businesses we see and run, both of us are chartered accountants, we don't come across this complex process of putting up and what happens next. And I think that was the easiest part of your highly illuminating talk. I am fascinated also by your pecking order. I mean, we knew there was some order, and thanks for informing us. Maybe the way as civilians, as ordinary citizens, when we react to this order also, I think it will help us in understanding who we are talking to. The first question I have is this. You did refer to the British Civil Service, and we are now 75 years since independence. How come those traditions are still so strong that we are not able to run away from it? I mean, there must have been something very good for us to continue a tradition. How come the wrong practices, which you seem to be highlighting, are continuing? I mean, this is something which can you help me in that?
You see, a train, railway engine and coaches run on rails, okay? And the rail size, the breadth of the rails, the width of the rails determine the size of the coach. In other words, the British have left behind small gauge, meter gauge, and broad gauge. You have to choose which gauge you're running on, unless you come up with the Indian gauge. We have not come up with an Indian gauge. We have not broken free. Because as you can think in the example of the railways, there's a huge overhaul cost. But I still say the overhaul cost is worth it. It's still worth it. We should have gone 70 years, 75 years. It's a long time for us to have gone on this patchwork arrangement that Sardar Patel and Pandit Nehru decided. If we continue with this same everything, we are not referring only to the law and order part. The law and order part is one part on which we need a separate sort of attention. The post-law and order phase, what we call the directorate, the secretariat, the public services phase, where we have to determine, is somewhere I can assure you that some new public service initiatives that started the last 30, 40 years while we were there, the Anganwadi workers, for instance, very low cost, very low paid, almost exploitative, but a certain amount of service being rendered directly at the cutting edge. That is what we needed more and more and more. We have managed to bureaucratize everything from school education to public health, everything we have managed to bureaucratize because the overall aura, the overall ethos, the mahal is in that direction. Every time you set up something, we start with saying one director, 3 additional directors, 13 joint directors, 27 deputy directors, you know, that pyramid thinking. Instead of having pyramid thinking, why can't you go for a modular thinking? So while these are taught, these are not allowed to be practiced because the environment does not allow. Every time you come up with something new, we have something called finance. Of course, I can't name because I was also in finance for many years. There's another mentality there at work. Now, what trick is he coming with to make me shell out more money? So they have their attitude to it. So we need these things. We need an occasional outing out of the city together.
I have just one more thing. I'm also part of an NGO. We work with children and child labor. And in our 3 decades of our work, our experience has been that it's very difficult for the bureaucrat to change his mind, who seems to be knowing everything. And our field experience is never looked at. Whereas when we talk to the politician, we're able to tell him that this is what is happening in the field, and this is, and he is able to lead and understand the movement better than the bureaucrat. So my complaint is this: bureaucrats are not only what you also said; they are also very fixed in their biases and prejudices. Can you help me in that?
I do admit that this fixity of bias is encouraged. It's a gang philosophy, you know. It's a group philosophy. It's a gang philosophy. Somebody says that the moment you send people for training, everybody becomes 12 years old. You reach your teenage. So these fixations are there. But then they still can be cured. When you look at the same individual officers as sub-divisional magistrate, as district magistrate, when you see the fellow roll up his jeans and cross streams with backpacks to go and deliver. So there is a lot of missionary thing, and there is also a lot of pomposity about people who never sort of sully their would never get into the ground and would just love to remain behind red lights and what have you. An occasional taking off by the boss and an occasional recording by the boss, that pomposity is not everything, will cure him. But if he can get away with it, if his boss is also bringing in in-laws and outlaws in 7 cars and moving around, he also does it. So there is a certain amount of transparency and public check. I've been so glad that these are all coming out, that the visual media is coming out with the slightest transgression. Hathras is a very good example of a criminal district magistrate. I'm using the filtered term of a criminal district magistrate who colluded with a terrible administration to cover up. Hathras in UP, where the gang rape victim was cremated. Here is something that should have come out to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court needs to be a little more hyperactive.
Yeah.
You know, the PIL system and the direct cognizance system. Hathras was a case where instead of concentrating all energies in stopping a Muslim journalist from reaching and putting him in jail for the next 1 year or something, the attention should have been focused on the criminal district magistrate that I said, and make an example out of it. Hang him from upside down. That's all. Such criminality could have been cut through by the Supreme Court, because the highest executive in India would not be doing it, because the UP administration is run by its crony. So somebody has to step in. Civil society shouted a lot. Human rights organizations shouted a lot. The media also shouted a lot. But ultimately, the punitive measure, the lightning strike, could have been delivered by the Supreme Court. Unfortunately, we had 3 Supreme Court's chief justices about whom we can write full books. We had a Supreme Court judge who was conniving with the Adanis, giving judgments after judgments with Adani. They are all matters of record. You know, Ajay, the problem is there is no fear of punishment in the majority religion here. Abrahamic religion still have the day of judgment. Here, everything is on current accounting basis. This life, you become, nobody really believes he's going to become a dog in the next life. Yeah. So with such no accounting, there is no concept of hell that you can go to. So you get away with it. Get away with it. That's the point. You get away with it. There's no fear of punishment.
Sujata. You're muted, Sujata. Sujata, you're muted.
You know, you said that there's an increasing amount of politicization of the bureaucracy, particularly the higher levels. But also at the lower levels, I know where I'm told that, you know, there is such an infiltration of, say, for example, RSS cadres getting into the lower bureaucracy, and there is that process going on, is what I'm told by colleagues in the government. But then what do you make of this word neutrality of the IAS? Is it possible at all? Or is that a concept we should now give up altogether? And is it better that the Prime Minister just chooses his own party people like in the US and then, you know, dismantle the whole idea, so to say?
You see, I would put it like this: just because there is adultery, just because there are breaches, the institution of marriage does not collapse. The institution of marriage is much too solid to bear up with this, to bear up with transgressions. The institution of neutrality in the civil services is still a viable thing, number one. I know for certain that even the people who were handpicked by the central government, even they have their lines where they draw it. As I said, otherwise this repay back, I don't call it privatization, I don't call it national monetization plan. These are all fancy words for repayment. Repayment to those who have given me a lot of finance during this election. So I've given you figures. These can be controlled. These can be, he's getting away with everything, can be controlled by a fiat, by a directive, saying that for every such beneficiary of every such privatization, whatever monetization, whatever you have to give in the public domain that the beneficiary, the buyer, the rescuer, call him whatever, did not pay you directly or indirectly, did not support you. You know, a clause like that, like we have, when I stood for this election or nomination for the Rajya Sabha, the amount of details I have to give, I said, oh God, with so much details, how did this guy get away with it? So all my details are up there on the public website, which national savings certificate I bought and which day it will be encashed. Going for transparency, going for net, going for the net, going for websiting, and going for vigilante groups that will catch on this, like the ADR and the very, very vigilante groups. That's the only way to save the nation now. The civil service is only a part of it. A part of it has succumbed. A large part of it is playing, is faking it, as I keep saying, is faking affection. They can do it. Large to medium part of it is an active connivance, And when you talk of RSS infiltration, let me assure you, I have seen the infiltration of communist cadres in administration in Bengal for 34 years. And after they were wiped off in the last 10 years, the actual numbers have come down to a minuscule percentage. Only the dedicated communists are the ones there. Those who practice, those who pretend to be RSS will all disappear. There'll be a hardcore ideological group that we have to agree to, because we are in a democracy.
I have a few issues which go to some fundamentals. I'll club 2-3 thoughts and put them to you for your response. The first is when we got independence, there was a transfer of power from the British to the Indian bureaucrats, Indian civil service. What was needed was independence from
the system itself, and that was not happened. It's just that the Indian bureaucrats replaced, or the Indian civil services replaced the British civil service that was there. And there was no cultural transformation that happened of the civil service, which brought about a sense of a commitment to the purpose of a civil servant. And this is one thought that has been voiced by several intellectuals, that which is also one of the reasons Gandhi said that independence is not going to make India the Indian poor get what he deserves. The second point is the bureaucracy as it has been built up does not seem to have a sense of understanding of constitutional values, of the value of the citizens' rights and how to respect them. There is a sense of entitlement that comes into the bureaucrat's mind and a sense of power. All these together work to make sure that the citizen doesn't get what he deserves. He doesn't get governed, he gets ruled, whether it is by the political class or by the bureaucracy. How do you react to this?
You see, both of these are true. We have discussed two transfers, smooth transfers, if I may use. One from post-Mughal administration to the early colonial period. It didn't happen overnight like in 1947. It happened over a period of at least 50 years, between, say, 1757 and 1810. This was the period 1813, that is the first Government of India Act. Now, these periods were when the transfers took place. The problem is, it's almost like, how do I put it? It's a very sensitive form of transfer. It's like an hospital emergency. You can't shut it down for a day, for a second, and yet you transfer the personnel. You understand? You are actually changing drivers by asking the next driver to come near you, hold the steering while you move off to the side, and you gradually tell him to take control over the other parts, that the clutch and the gear, and you slide off. It's a very difficult process. So there are no homemade rules where you can sort of shut it down for a minute and say, let me get off the car. This car cannot stop. So it's happened twice. It's happened once in the early British period, and it's happened in the post-British period. One of the reasons why this continuation thing continues, but that having the second driver in position now, there is always a scope for going in for sectoral changes. You know, you take a sector of a building, you remove all the plaster, get on to the supporting structures, get on to the steel joists, cut them off, weld them up. We have done these things. No? So that was not eminently successful because of the prevailing mentality. I give it the mentality of the Tehsildar or the Kannam on one side and the mentality of the Anganwadi worker on the other side. I don't know, they've given some other fancy name to the Anganwadi worker, health worker, whatever it is. I call them Anganwadi because we recruited them as Anganwadi. The ones who advise women and babies, who provide nutrition. So these are two separate mentalities. India has to move at a painful cost. Make it painful. Make it painful. I remember in the districts when my wife and I used to go to see a movie unannounced. Of course, we sent somebody to get the tickets before, that's all. And he too, he was under oath of secrecy, not to mention. And we moved in, we got in good chairs and sat in. Suddenly, flashlights are flashed on my face. Sir, aap kaise hai? Aap kaise hai? You know, you are dealing with the feudal society. You're dealing with the feudal society. So you will get this. And the transfer from one to the other the amount of feudalism that we see all around is something inescapable. Complete inescapable. Unless there is a societal change, you won't get this change coming in. That we leave the bureaucracy out, we decide not to salam them, not to be there. It's part of a continuum. It's part of a continuum of behavior. So I guess we'll have to change the external environment. There's a lot of changes that has happened. It's not the same when we came in. It's not the same. There are large sections of the governed in India, the ruled, as you put it, the ruled in India, who are extremely conscious. You know, one of the reasons why it could be a little more reckless is for the last few years, when government decided that I was not serious enough to run serious departments like home or defense or something, they gave me silly departments like education, media, culture. I enjoyed them. Harady enjoyed them. I'm sure Sujata also would be enjoying them, because here the client base is not one that looks up to the administrator. They look down at them. An education, a vice chancellor or a college teacher looks down at the education secretary as a seminary fellow sitting there. So it's a very enjoyable interaction. Enjoyable. I have forgotten what the word sir meant until it's only the first half of my surname. But in education, in culture, in this and that, when you see the tantrums all around, this disinfects you of whatever little bit. The last 15 years I've been doing this. So practically a jholawala's job. But when I still look at my fellows in petroleum who think they really matter, they're not actually the agent of somebody's enrichment, but they actually matter. I feel a bit of pity for them, that's all. That's all. They do land up with independent directorship, whatever that is called, and make much more income in 1 year than they did while in service. But
The context of what you said, there was a gentleman who was the chairman of the Central Vigilance Commissioner. And soon after retirement, he was appointed as director on the board of Reliance Industries and drawing a fat salary. What does it tell you about the status of how we are?
Now, I am not... See, whenever I compare the three prime ministers, Mr. Vajpayee, eloquent, Dr. Manmohan Singh, whom I served rather closely, not eloquent, and the third person, I won't describe, I leave it to you. Only one has claimed that he's going to purge dishonesty from India and all that. He's the ones who's taken the maximum pains. I'm telling you, every important directorship in every major private company that is aided and assisted by financial institutions. You know, you have FI represented there. Everything is determined by one data pool. Is he against me? Is he for me? Will he listen? Is he user-friendly? And they get humongous salaries. A tobacco giant in Calcutta gives humongous salaries, humongous payments out to this thing. But that post is reserved for somebody who comes in with a nod from the right quarters somewhere in Raisina Hill. So you understand. The Tata post that I mentioned that went down to a friend of ours who left the diplomatic services was again rewarded before he came back again to Raisina Hill. So this sort of thing is happening in a more acute form now. I need to get conscious on that. During Dr. Manmohan Singh's period, any minister could have his swagger and say, hey, this guy is my man. I want him in Indian Oil. I want him here. I want him there. Finished. But right now, it's a one-man show. One-man show.
You'd expect that the youth to be full of idealism and a little more honest than older people. And that a kind of idealism which people during freedom struggle had. And maybe they should have been recruited into the civil service. But the point I'm trying to make is this. When youth are not selected from the field, but are recruited through this process of maximizing IITs and IIMs, maybe they don't exactly reflect this kind of honesty. I mean, I hope I'm clear in my question. A larger number of people who have come through IITs and who are well educated, but the method of recruitment of them does not represent the people who we could have chosen. They need not be well educated and have degrees and write exams, but they would have made wonderful civil servants. Are we promoting a culture like that?
Well, I'll put it like this. I have seen some of the finest officers from IITs also. So, I mean, I'll be fair to them. It's not their fault they went through IITs. So there's a technocratic invasion of the IAs and other services. It's only a question of structuring the examination once again, restructuring. When we came in, average people like us from the humanities and social sciences could get in and did get in. History was a favorite subject. Whenever I hear this Shaktikant Das being mocked by saying MA in history, but MA in history is not a liability. The fact that he did not get his MSc or doctorate in economic does not make him, below sea level person. I mean, that's not the way of treating. He had the sharp qualities to be there. Of course, some of his acts and others, I have my own issues. Point is, if you want this thing to be spread out more across the spectrum so that people come in, you know, idealism is something. If you ask at every beauty pageant, at the end of a beauty pageant, if you put the sash on the girl who won Miss World or Miss Universe and ask her, and take the mic to her. She has this well-rehearsed thing. What are you going to do? Well, I'm going to serve my nation. I mean, nation through advertising, through endorsements, I don't know what. But so we have this fixed thing. If you've noticed, Ajay, they all come up to say that I'm here to serve my nation, Miss Barbados or Miss whatever. Now, here again, serving the nation becomes a cliche that's imbibed. You know, basically, as an old man, I put it like this. It comes to many, it just doesn't come to many. To those it doesn't come to, they have to be gently and not so gently reminded. You are in a public service. You are not here for anything else. You are in a public service. The word government and others should be replaced again and again by the word public service. Public service. And keep reminding, there's a name. There's shaming game going on every day in the social media. Now, here is the Prime Minister of Sweden traveling by underground. We only hope that these filter into our system and this sort of gets in. But then when you see that every important minister gets a cavalcade of 14 cars even now, and all, even Parliament is, when I was entering Parliament, my car, which is a Parliament car anyway, was stopped. And I asked the driver, what's happening? Bola, route lagi hai. You know what that means? Prime Minister's route is in position. That means route lagi hai. Route lagi hai. So, it goes on the same thing. I used to see it 20 years ago, 15 years ago. It's the same thing. There's no change. I mean, Man Ki Baat does not come out in translation ki. I come out in one car and sort of one guy in front, one guy behind. I don't know if 13 cars behind and 13 cars above and below can really actually do wonders. Like that.
One follow-up in the context of the qualities of a bureaucrat. Today's news of an STM telling his the police and the army, the police people, that they should go out and hit up the heads of farmers if they cross the border was outrageous. But this seems to be happening every day now.
It is. There is a large degree of connivance that's going on, especially in states like UP and Haryana and others. where it's more evident, because that is they're encouraged. The next promotion will depend upon their arrogance, upon such aggression. It's obvious. I remember during the communist period also, we had a lot of these state people who keep on saying such things. These, if the court takes immediate umbrage, you see, the central government won't, the state government won't. Okay, so he gets away with it. The public can cry, shout a bit and all that, but they're used to it. Their skins come in separate textures and thicknesses. We call different BGs of skins. So somebody has to take umbrage. Somebody has to take umbrage and tell him where he gets off. But I can rest assured, I have also spoken to the farmers. They can take care of these fellows. They can do likewise. So it's only that they have not done it so far.
There's one interesting question here, sir. How will you appreciate the current trend of quitting from civil services and joining political parties by even young civil servants?
Well, I'm an old civil servant who has been drawn into politics. They keep saying for no fault of his. I've been a critical writer, writing critical pieces, and people thought that I should come in. I would actually encourage it. Instead of, capitalizing on your last 5 years with selfless service to the RSS or to the CPIM or to the Tribunal Congress or whatever, and then in cashing on it for a legislative assembly seat or a ministership or for an MP-ship, it is much better that you come out early and join them. Imagine the police commissioner of Bombay talks of it, and the day he resigns, he stands for an MP seat. What the hell is going on? So do you think that from the day, with 5 years or 10 years before his date of resignation, he was neutral? He has been working himself craftily towards that objective. Isn't it? My preceding 5 years was retired, so there's no way I could work myself.
Jawahar, we have taken a lot of your time. There are still several questions which are unanswered. But we have to bring this to a close. Yeah. So, cannot thank you enough for spending this morning with us. You gave us so much to think, so much to understand and learn. I have learned a lot about civil services listening to you. It was a joy. Vikram SM,
your voice is breaking. I just wanted to close it by asking one question. Is that we have all, you just left with a ray of hope that there are many, many honest officers in the service at all levels. And there must be a system of, it's unfortunate, but we must also have a system of rewarding honesty rather than, punishing the dishonest. It must be extensively, even at the lowest level, where you feel proud that you're an ordinary officer in a municipal corporation, but if you're honest, you're somewhere, you're recognized. Do you think that as a method of reform?
You see, you cannot institutionalize attitudes. You cannot institutionalize values. You can pressurize people from outside. Let me tell you the highest reward to an officer of that type. It's his own conscience, number one, and the select amount of respect that he gets amongst his colleagues and family. Having, making tons of money, my cousin, who's also in the IAS, was noted to be corrupt and indulging in certain other things that I would never dare to. And so, in the same wedding that we went, in the same place where we went, I could see the differential statement. He may have come in a swank car with a lot of fancy clothes and all that, But fact remains that people treated us differently. Now, at least I hope so. I hope to keep myself under the illusion that that is the reward within yourself, within the family. You can look at your son with respect.
Yes, most
you can look at your son with respect. You understand? Your family with respect, and that's all we need. I mean, what? You can't wear two shirts. We can't have an automobile that's bigger than this thing. And you can't carry them upstairs. There are no traveler's checks to where you're going. So why go in for all this? That's the way I look at it. And I assure you that most of the bureaucracy is still honest. Your system would have collapsed if all the fans above your head stopped functioning. They are still there. They do it for a pittance. They wish at times the DA was released more. They have this small, festival advances. That's all. They are working there because they are proud of the tricolor. They are proud of this thing. They are proud of the society they serve. That is still there. Let's not be cynical. The civil service is still driven by this thing that distinguishes him from his brother, who may be drawing four times more, but he feels a greater sense of satisfaction that I've done something beyond selling boot polishes all my life.
That was a great note to close this on. This
was that gives us a lot of reassurance that the next 30 years will be better than the last 5 years.
Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Jawahar. We are hugely grateful to you for doing thank this. You. And we look forward to having your continued support and participation to month end.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for spending this morning with us. Next Sunday, we have Pranay Kotasthane, who has spoken at month end earlier, who will speak to us on the pitfalls of public policy, pitfalls and principles. So do join in and keep tuned. Thank you very much for being with us.